Hold on tight for the next hour. You're entering into a place, a zone called the alternative to the alternative media. It's a place, a special place, where even truth seekers fear to tread.
All right, people, let's move like you've got a purpose.
Affirmative.
Okay, Greg Anthony here, and glad you're back on the Investigative Journal on this April 25th, 2017 day on our calendar. And today I want to talk about how the Vatican was intricately involved in the Holocaust. And I'm doing that because yesterday was International Holocaust Remembrance Day. Now, it falls on a different date every year, so it's hard to keep track of sometimes. But the reason why is that it's the international recognized date for Holocaust Remembrance Day corresponds to the 27th day of the Nisan on the Hebrew calendar. It marks the anniversary of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. I'll get to that later. In Hebrew, Holocaust Remembrance Day is called Yom HaShoah. When the actual date of Yom HaShoah falls on Friday, the State of Israel observes Yom HaShoah on the preceding Thursday. A little confusing. When it falls on a Sunday, Yom HaShoah is observed on the following Monday. So this year, it's observed yesterday on Monday, April 24th, 2017. Last year it was Thursday, May 5th, and next year it'll be Thursday, April 12th. Okay, enough for the dates. So I'm going to spend most of the show talking about how the Vatican was intricately involved in this. And it's close to my heart because many people don't realize that prior to Hitler's invasion of Poland, why did they choose Poland? Well, it had the most eclectic and the largest Jewish population in all of Europe. Over 3.5 million Jews lived in Poland, many in the Warsaw Ghetto, which turned into the Warsaw Ghetto because it was a very, very prosperous city until Hitler and the Vatican had to get rid of all the Jews. Now, they not only got rid of all the Jews, they always say, oh, 6 million Jews were killed. I believe the figures are a lot higher than that. Some estimate that the total number of people were about 18 million, and not only Jews, but many other people that stood in the way of the Vatican. Crazy. And as you look throughout history, I say the blood on there, that on St. Peter's Square is about 10 feet deep. It's amazing what they've done if we really look at it. And as I'm speaking, I'm watching President Trump. It's probably a tape of what he did earlier, and I believe the tape says it came at 11:33 a.m. Eastern Time. He was giving a speech and honoring those who died during the what he called the history's darkest hour and those survivors. Not one word will be mentioned about the Vatican. In fact, he's going to go have a little party with the Pope in a month or so. And that's what I'm going to center on because the media will not cover it. And in fact, they probably will say it's hate speech. That's where they're going. Okay, so I've got a lot to talk about on that, but I want to cover two things real quickly before I do that. One is yesterday I made a statement that the International Space Station doesn't exist because space, as we know, it doesn't exist. And it's a big deception by NASA. So someone emailed me and said, well, where do they go then? We just watched President Trump yesterday speak with the woman who set the record. Supposedly, he was talking to America and talking to the lady astronaut, who supposedly broke the record and has now been in the International Space Station for 532 days. Wow. And I said, wow, this is a big deception. It can't exist. And from the computer-generated images of the faulty design of the space station to simple things like, how do they go to, did you ever, I looked in depth on how they would go to the bathroom there. It would be impossible. And the way they depict it, it is crazy. They'd be sleeping in their own urine and feces. They say they don't even do laundry there. Can you imagine what it would be like to be? And how did they say get around that? They can't use it because of the water consumption. This is what they say. They say they throw their clothes away. They don't take showers. How could this woman exist 532 days like this? It's incredible the lies and the deception. So people said, well, you can go and really go and look at all the real good investigators who really piece it together, all these little problems that most people, 99% of the people in America, won't even consider. And you will come to the same conclusion that I came to, that the probability of there being a space station is kind of like Mickey Mouse actually being alive and well today, an actual talking mouse. It's about the same thing. So anyway, go and look at it yourself before you criticize. And remember, they're part of the beast system. And if you want to understand break away from the beast, you got to look at all of these things. Now, person then said to me, Greg, well, where do these people go then? If she's not in space, where does she go? Well, I did some checking, and you'd be surprised where they probably do most of their training. I mean, they do a lot at NASA pre-flight, right? But when they get these space people that are supposed to be gone for all these periods of time, and the serious training, and all of the technical things they have to do on the ground to make it look like a space station, so they're filming things, they don't want to do it in America. And let me tell you why they don't want to do it in America, because we've got a little bit more open system here, and probably the chances of getting caught are greater than if you went to a place that exists called Star City Moscow. Now, the center was established in the 1960s. It's about 30 to 40 kilometers or miles outside of Moscow in a very remote area. And they've been training astronauts. Our astronauts have been going there for years, along with Russian astronauts, along with Japanese. They're all over there. You can check it out. Just Google Star City Moscow and read all about it. It's trained, it says, over 400 astronauts and cosmonauts, and it's a huge facility, very private. No one's allowed in. In fact, there's only been one person that's gotten pictures, and he's showing some of the things. I'm looking at it. So here's what's happening. And then I checked to see, well, have they been there recently? And here's what I found out. Expedition, this was printed on May 27, 2016. Expedition 4849, Soyuz commander Anatoly Ivanchin of Russia, and flight engineers Kate Rubens of NASA and Takayuna Oshina of Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency, along with their backups of NASA, are training at the Star City Gagarin Cosmonaut Training Center in Star City, Russia. And that was the last year. So I got some. They're doing it every day. So they got a huge facility there. And I believe that that woman who's been in space for 532 days is hid out in Russia. And they do all of their ground filming of their deceptions there. It's very, Russia, they can keep people away. No one's allowed to go there. I don't see any journalists ever bringing this up. If we're at odds with Russia, why do they always get together over there and train together with our astronauts? And everybody gets together. This is where they hide out, I believe. They don't go into space because they can't. And so somebody, if you guys out there are journalists, please uncover the hoax of NASA. Well, you get it on the internet with internet sleuths, but you're never going to get it in the mainstream media. So there's what I propose to be the place where they train and where they hide out and do all of their filming. They can't go to a Hollywood set because it would be too open, right? Anyway, Star City, Moscow, check it out. Move on. This moves on to one other subject before I want to get to the Holocaust. And boy, I probably could do 20 hours. I've done hours and hours about the Holocaust because it's very dear to me. I've lost many of my family, if you don't know, both sides of my family are from Poland. and half of my family is Jewish, half is Catholic, and many of my family were killed in the Holocaust in Poland. So I don't know a lot of my family members, and I'm probably lucky to be here. So, in fact, my mother was Jewish, my father not. So anyway, technically they say I'm Jewish, although I've never practiced Judaism. Okay, so we'll get to that in a minute. But what was interesting yesterday, now many of you know that I've been a journalist most of my adult life and got into it as a young, right out of college, was the editor of my college paper, and I was gung-ho. I wanted to save the world, so to speak. And when I was taught journalism and when I learned how to do it, basically it was supposed to be you give the facts on both sides so people can make up their mind. And you do it in a way that's as fair as possible, but you make it interesting so people read. Back when I started, you know, now everybody that goes to school wants to be a broadcast journalist, get their face, you know, plastered on TV or on YouTube. Back when I was a journalist, the print media was still very important. People still got ink on their hands and read the newspaper, not like today. But anyway, as things have moved, what's happened in America is completely bogus right now. And yesterday, and occasionally I do this, I play something on the mainstream to prove my point. What we have going is the worst case of the best case of the Hegelian dialectic I've ever seen. The left-wing media is blasting the right-wing media. The right-wing media is blasting the left-wing. And all these people are caught up in this. And are you one of those that's either a left-winger or a right-winger, not realizing that both of them work together because they do not cover the major stories? They will not cover anything about the hypocrisy of NASA and all of NASA's deceptions. That's one thing they won't do. They will never cover the Vatican's, and I'll just use the Holocaust, their support of Hitler and their being intricately involved in the Holocaust. They'll never talk about that. And what they're doing, basically, is setting us up for a fall. And if we get this kind of fighting between the left and the right wing, many people will never, ever get to the truth. I'm telling you, it's amazing to me as a journalist because I see, and there's my horse, he always seems to want to drink during my show. So people say, do you do your show in a barn? No, I do not. I do it in a little studio, and I have a dog that's about as big as a horse. And he likes to listen to the show and get educated so he can tell all his dog friends about what's really going on in America. And I consider Max, my famous Malamute, to be the most educated dog in America because he has listened to this show for 10 years. He's going on 10. Are you going on 10, Max? He's coming over. He says, no, I'm going outside. Go ahead. Okay, so I'll be talking, you know, probably what will happen, I'll at least have enough time in the second half hour to begin my discussion on the intricate involvement of the Vatican and the Jesuits in the Holocaust. And I'll try to wrap it up in a half hour, but there's much, much more. I've go back to many of my shows regarding that. But anyway, getting back to the media, and this plays right into what I want to talk about. Now, people have no idea. I remember I was doing a show about the Jesuit and the Vatican involvement about the Revolutionary War. So yesterday, or the day before, I had my dog out, and I said, I asked at least 10 people, because everybody comes up to my dog. So I said, do you know who was involved in the Revolutionary War? Who was fighting in the Revolutionary War? Do you know 7 out of 10 people didn't even know who was fighting in the Revolutionary War? Now, granted, I live in an immigrant community, so to speak, so many people have no idea, even probably who the first president is. But anyway, but I didn't only talk to people that just arrived off the boat. I talked to people that looked like they should be in college that had no idea. Isn't that amazing? 7 out of 10. Boy, and we... And you expect people to understand what the Hegelian dialectic is? We got a lot of work to do. A lot of work to do to educate people about really what's going on. So if you have this, I've never seen such fighting between the media, you know, the left fighting the right. You see Trump, you know, it's also reflected in our politics. We see nothing but hate. You know, these people are just fighting each other, and they're doing it for a reason, because it keeps the people occupied. But their whole goal, they're all working together. And Sean Hannity yesterday really lashed out. And this will give you an idea of what we're up against, because none of these people, whether they're on the left or the right, will ever want to get to the real stories that need to be told, like many of the ones you get here. And let's see what Sean Hannity had to say. It's about 5 minutes, so it's not going to take up that much time. Let's see what he said. You're going to see how this Hegelia and dialectic plays out. Here we go.
To start tonight by addressing a well-orchestrated effort by the intolerant left in this country that is designed to silence every conservative voice and by any means necessary. Now, I am speaking out tonight so that you, our audience, will understand what is really happening here and what is really at stake when it comes to freedom of speech in this country. Now, these tactics are right out of Saul Alinsky's Rule for Radicals playbook. I've worked in radio for 30 years. I've been right here at the Fox News Channel for 21 and a half years. I'm very proud of that. And during this time, there's always been efforts and attempts to smear and slander and besmirch me and other conservatives. But it has never been as intense and completely insane as it is right now. Now, I want you to understand, every single minute, every single second, I am on the air, radio, TV, here's somebody, likely being paid, recording and monitoring every single word that comes out of my mouth, all in the hopes that I may say something they can twist and distort and use against me and try and destroy my reputation, get my conservative voice off the air. Now, it's only gotten worse in the age of President Trump. Now, it's no secret I've been a supporter of the president and, of course, his policies. And quite simply, he's liberal fascist. They can't stand conservative voices. Now, for those of you who don't know me well, I have a pretty thick skin. I call out people, I say things, I give my point of view 4 hours a day, and for all these years, well, there has been endless, unrelenting attacks against me. But now, in light of recent events, I have come to the conclusion I can no longer remain silent, and I can no longer let the left slander against me slide. So from now on, and I want you to be informed of what I'm doing and why I'm doing it, if there's any person, any group, any organization, any media outlet that slanders, lies about me, besmirches me, my character, I'm going to be calling them out. Because at this point, enough is enough. I have hired a team of some of the best attorneys in this country to work with me and on my behalf. Now, the breaking point for me came this weekend when an individual who for over a decade has made the most outrageous, unfair, untrue allegations against me has now resurfaced by making ridiculous and completely untrue claims. Now, this person went on a radio show on Friday and made more unfounded accusations against me, which this person is now, interestingly, recanting after I made my statement, but it was only after I responded to these baseless and false smears. This is not the first time I've had to deal with this individual. Now, this person has repeatedly spread lies about me. I'll give you an example. Back in 2010, remember, I was raising money for the Freedom Alliance, a charity that offers college scholarships to the children of killed veterans, severely injured veterans, and their families. And in a blog post, the individual falsely accused me and members of the charity of skimming and stealing money that was donated. This, of course, was easily proven false. And in spite of the fact that we proved each and every single allegation to be untrue and inaccurate at the time, I was never given an apology. There was no correction that was issued. Now this person has made yet another slanderous accusation. And in response, I've released this statement, which now the press has picked up, and I'll read it for you. Let me be clear. The comments about me on a radio show this week by this individual are 100% false and a complete fabrication. This individual is a serial harasser who has been lying about me for well over a decade. The individual has a history of making provably false statements against me in an effort to slander, smear, besmirch my reputation. The individual has not just slandered me over the years, but also many people who this individual disagrees with. This individual desperately seeks attention by any means necessary, including making unfounded personal attacks and using indefensible and outrageous political rhetoric. My patience with this individual is over. I have retained a team of some of the finest and toughest lawyers in the country who are now in the process of laying out the legal course of action we will be taking against this individual. Now, in this fiercely divided and vindictive political climate, I will no longer allow slander and lies about me to go unchallenged, as I see this now to be a coordinated effort afoot to now silence those with conservative views. I will fight every single lie about me by any and all legal means available to me as an American. Now, I want you to know, my audience, to understand the importance of what is happening here. This is not about Sean Hannity. This is not about one person. There's now a coordinated attempt to silence the voice of every outspoken conservative in this country. If we don't stop it right now, there won't be any conservative voices on radio and television left. Now, I'm not the only one that these liberal fascists routinely target. Like me, conservatives are monitored on radio and TV every word they say. And contrary to the alt-radical left stated position, they're so open-minded liberals. Not true. Liberal fascism is alive and well in America today. Their goal is simple. They want to shut up, shut down, completely silence all conservative voices by any means necessary. Here's the difference. Unlike the left, I don't have any problem with what the other side says. If you want to listen to liberals on radio or TV, read their articles, follow them on social media, go for it. Now, I'll call them out for their bias. I'll explain why they're wrong. I'll debate them. But I'll never, ever say they should be silenced. And I won't support boycotts to attack their advertisers, a roundabout way of silencing them. So let me be clear tonight. Everyone who has publicly supported President Trump is a target. This is very political. We have seen repeatedly that the left knows no limits in these efforts. They have gone after and attacked the First Lady. They have attacked members of the president's family, every White House advisor. They've even attacked his daughter and his 10-year-old son.
Okay, so there you have it. I got about 3 minutes here. Let me explain real quickly. So we have the left really trying to silence the conservatives, conservatives fighting back, saying freedom of speech no longer exists. But the real travesty here is that none of them ever get to the real truth. And they're playing this game, covering both sides of the right and left agenda, which is the Jesuit agenda, to keep you occupied so that the real freedom of speech, both of these, the liberal fascists, the conservative fascists, never want the real truth that comes out on many of these alternative shows to ever reach the light of day. And both those organizations, both the left and right media, work to monitor, control, and snuff out the real truth seekers, the real people who want to get to the truth. So what do you have? You have the Hegelian dialectic working. They got you right. And I've never seen so much entertainment journalism as what he's talking about. Because when you, if you fall into the left, if you fall into Sean Hannity's conservative views, you fight like tooth and nail against the left. If you fall into the left and CNN's views, you fight tooth and nail against Hannity and his conservatives. And both of them never really want you to get to the real truth and will fight against you and people like me on these shows who I've came from the mainstream. And I see hypocrisy every day. I just saw it when Trump was talking about the Holocaust. He didn't want to get to the truth behind, you know, Pope Pius XII and really what was going on with Hitler and IBM's backing of Hitler. And, you know, without IBM, they could have never kept track of all the Jews. You know, so listen, don't fall prey to it. That's what they're doing. And the real people that are the real truth and freedom of speech that's being stopped is yours. You to be able to look at things from a different angle that the left and the right, who are playing the Jesuit Hegelian game, won't let you do. That's the real story behind the story. And I hope by listening to Hannity, you get the point. And so we got a whole half hour to get into the intricate involvement of the Vatican and the Holocaust. On yesterday was Holocaust Remembrance Day. Back in 3 minutes on the Investigative Journal.
Visit crosstheborder.org, crossstheborder.org, to get your print, EPUB, or PDF version of Nicholas Arthur's new book titled When the Third Temple is Built. That's crosstheborder.org. When it comes to prophecy today, much of the evangelical Christian world has their eyes on Israel, waiting and watching to see when the third temple will begin to be built. The plans are drawn. The Jewish people are eager. Most evangelical Christians today believe that the rapture will happen before the third temple is built. Hi, I'm Michael Eugene. I was taught that Daniel's 70th week was in the future. Is that really what the Bible teaches? Have we searched the scriptures and found this to be true? Why is it so important for a re-established Israel to build a third temple in Jerusalem? Is it necessary to build a temple on the same location already occupied by the Dome of the Rock? Is it necessary for sacrifices to take place in the temple on Temple Mount? Is there really a rapture followed by 7 years of tribulation? What is the New Testament temple? Can we identify history and prophecy? Who is the first beast in Revelation chapter 13? Who are the seven kings in Revelation 17? I have asked all these questions, and I have found Nicholas Arthur's new book, When the Third Temple is Built, answers all these questions and more using Scripture to interpret Scripture. The Bible says that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation. Nicholas shows us in his new book, When the Third Temple is Built, how the Bible interprets prophecy and not man's private interpretation. Visit crosstheborder.org, C-R-O-S-S, crosstheborder.org, to get your print, EPUB, or PDF version of Nicholas Arthur's new book titled When the Third Temple is Built. That's crosstheborder.org.
The program you are listening to is 100% sponsored by you, the listener, on this First Amendment Rights Media channel. You will notice that there are few commercials on this radio network. There's a good reason for that. Corporate advertising dollars come with strings that limit program content. So without your help, these programs cannot continue on internet or our several affiliates. If you benefit by the educational law programs, we ask you to give. If you are admonished or nurtured by the Bible and ministry programs, we ask you to give. If some voice a cause that you are passionate about, we ask you to give. If you believe in any of these, we ask you to support them as you would a missionary on a continual basis, as if giving a tithe for missionary radio. These programs are not commercially viable and must be supported by those faithful to the cause of truth. Look for the button to sponsor your favorite programs at our listen and schedule pages on the internet. Then, when you subscribe, we will send you the last quarterly MP3 CD of that program immediately, and continue to do so with each new quarter. We will also give you unlimited archive access to all of our programs. We're asking you to give much less than a tithe, so that you may also send support directly to a particular program host, cause, and anywhere else the Spirit may lead you. Do all to the glory of our God and Creator, for His holy nation, the only kingdom that will last forever. Thank you for listening.
The following program is labeled dangerous and off-limits by the supreme Jesuit command, but stand tall, people. Listen up, and you may just learn something.
Okay, glad you're back for the second half hour of the Investigative Journal. Go to my website at arctic-beacon.com, arcticbeacon.com. You can get shows going back over a decade in what I call the Vatican-led New World Order. And before I get to talking about the Vatican's intricate involvement in the Holocaust and in World War II, let me say that, at Berkeley, just a little aside from what I was talking about regarding the Hegelian dialectic and the left and the right playing that game to a T on CNN and Fox, Ann Coulter, a conservative speaker, isn't being allowed to speak at Berkeley this week. And one of the pundits was saying just today, I was listening, said, this is heresy laws are being practiced in America against conservatives. Wow. And then I thought, the real heresy laws that are being practiced by both the left and the right and the Vatican-led New World Order are against truth seekers like you and me out here, who can't get stories based on fact into the mainstream. That is the real heresy law being practiced, to shut up Christians and people who want to get to the bottom of what's really going on behind the scenes. And, you know, I don't think it's going to change what we're looking at now. They're preparing something very big in the future. Big league, as Trump would say, to pare down the population and create some type of chaos in the world. We're just waiting for it. And I said it's going to happen during the Trump administration. That's his role, I believe. But anyway, here we go. Okay, the Vatican's intricate connection to the Holocaust. All right, I've spent many hours giving fact after fact that has been hidden by, and research is coming forward with information of how Hitler was involved with Pope Pius XII, and actually was that Pope Pius XII was Hitler's mentor, selected to do exactly what he did. We also forget about Stalin and the Stalin connection to the Vatican through, in fact, even a priest at Georgetown who started the School of Foreign Service, Father Edmund Walsh, Jesuit priest, who basically brokered the deal to get Stalin involved in the Bolshevik Party and led him into power. I call him Father Joseph Stalin. I've done many stories about how he was Jesuit trained. But anyway, this year, the Pope Francis made a disturbing statement. Yes, he did. Okay, so what I was saying was that at the beginning of the year, on New Year's, the Pope sent out an email, Pope Francis, extending good wishes to Jews all around the world. And I bet you he was snickering when he said that, knowing the Vatican's history. And to me, it was disturbing since it has been known for some time that the Vatican was complicit with the Nazis in World War II. Now, just to bring you up to date, Pope Pius XII was the Pope at the time, and it's a matter of public record that the Pope had cited, and I'm not even talking about all the facts that I've researched over the years that basically give a case. If I had to prove it in a court of law, there would be a unanimous verdict. Now, that, remember I mentioned Edmund Walsh, that Jesuit priest, who is also remembered on Ike's website? He was instrumental. He was also sent as the overseer during the trials at Nuremberg to make sure that nothing regarding the Vatican was put in the public record. And in fact, making sure that a lot of the real Nazis that were supposed should have been put in prison were given a free pass and ended up in Australia, America, South America, using the Vatican as a conduit to get to these places. Many of the Nazis, even the Nazi that started NASA, von Brunner, was helped by the Vatican to get here. And it's a matter of public record that that Pope had sided not only with Mussolini, but also with the Nazis who committed the Holocaust against 6 million Jews. And I say 6 million. They say 6 million. I think it's many more. The big question then is why, despite Pope Pius XII's well-known record, the Vatican prefers to ignore the crimes he has been associated with and raise him to sainthood. Many articles have been written about this, but you're not going to see the mainstream cover it. And you can talk about what I was talking about in the first half hour, the left and the right going back and forth playing that Hegelian dialectic, while the facts are show that they are covering not only for their leader, their satanic leader, now Pope Francis, but the Vatican's crimes against humanity for so long. There's an article that was written called "The Vatican Made Nazism Possible in Germany and Croatia." Google that. You'll see a lot of evidence. And I pulled three things out of that article that are interesting. One, the Catholic Church hierarchy acting under Vatican orders played a decisive role in making Hitler the dictator of Germany. B, Subsequently, the Catholic hierarchy was active in Nazi movements outside of Germany, for example in the Balkans, where the church was the institutional base of the Nazi puppet state of Croatia. How many times have I done shows regarding that genocide and a case that I covered many years with attorney John Levy, Alperin v. Vatican Bank, that was trying to get reparations for the survivors of that genocide that the Ninth Circuit threw out of court, saying the Vatican doesn't do business in the United States, and you don't think they cover for them? And see, although at Yad Vashem in the year 2000, Pope John Paul described the Nazis as having a godless ideology, and that was on the Holocaust Remembrance Day back in 2000. In 1933, when it mattered most, the Vatican ordered German Catholics to love, honor, and obey and protect Nazis. Oh, that's somehow forgotten, huh? But these are mere details and do not touch the reality and depth of the Vatican's central role in the Holocaust. And really, to understand this role requires a deep understanding of things first, including the connection between the Vatican, international child trafficking, child rape, and child and adult sacrifices. And an interesting fact that I'm going to bring up later. I remember researching years ago with a man by the name of Franco Collins from Australia. Now, he had close connections to high-level Jesuits. And he made a statement and uncovered information, which I verified through two other people that their names I can't tell you because for fear they fear their lives, who are close to information in Rome regarding the Jesuit involvement and the Vatican involvement at the concentration camps. Now, the real horrendous thing here is most people think that it's horrendous enough that they marched them in naked and then gassed them in while they were thinking the Jews were thinking they were getting a shower, then supposedly put them in carts and then put, you know, and then burn them alive in the ovens, correct? But the real story that goes uncovered is that were they actually dead when they were put in the ovens? And researchers have come to the conclusion that many were still breathing, and actually that was a satanic ritual sacrifice when they were burning these people alive. How horrendous. We'll get to that in a minute. But you have to understand all of these things. The real history behind the Vatican, and I was lucky to spend 7 years in Rome and got an opportunity to look at it from a very close vantage point. Now, remember when Ratzinger, the Pope that's still alive, who's hidden away in the Vatican with his boyfriend, I'm told, he was being... there were many people out to get him and charging him against crimes against humanity. And many say if he leaves the Vatican, he'd be arrested. I doubt that. But anyway, you have to look at what Ratzinger was all about. He was a Hitler youth, in fact. But also, in August of 4th, there was a huge... tribunal of a lot of different people who were proclaiming the Roman Catholic Church to be a transnational criminal body under international law, and the parties agreed that the time has arrived for decisive action on behalf of the victims of the papacy. Now, this ad hoc group was trying to get publicity. It was this international tribunal of crimes was never really had any kind of standing in the Vatican-led New World Order scheme of things in Europe, but it was a good ploy to get attention. But it was interesting that on September 1, after that occurred, the Pope released an apostolic letter which was meant to say that the Church was outside the reach of other courts. And also, the Vatican recently has put out information trying to whitewash what they really did in the Holocaust. They even said this, even worse, anyone who reports any of these crimes within the church, that's to do with child trafficking and anything, now faces even stiffer punishment for doing so. And the letter stated, this apostolic letter stated this, that I established that the competent judicial authorities of the Vatican City shall also exercise penal jurisdiction over crimes committed against the security fundamental interests of the patrimony of the Holy See. Penal jurisdiction means the power to prosecute and jail, and the same jurisdiction applies as well to any leakage of information from the church, including standing church laws, like crimum sola, I can't even pronounce it, the reporting of child rape and trafficking. And let me say this again, it's a crime under Catholic law to report a rape of a child. And amazing what this letter really stated. But remember, in Canada alone, we covered stories, the Vatican was involved in a genocide of over 50,000 native children. What about, and also we talked about the many Duplessis orphans. Go to that story, just Google Duplessis orphans. Many of these kids were tortured, murdered, and it was a response to the arrest brought to the Vatican that the previous pope resigned and went into hiding, perhaps. Plans to hold the Vatican accountable were tried to be driven forward, but it never seems to get anywhere, does it? But while these crimes appear to be hidden away by the media and everything, only child trafficking, rape, and human sacrifice, in fact, the most crucial things they must hide is their responsibility for the Holocaust, and more importantly, why they wanted it. To be able to grasp the scope of this evil involved, you have to understand that the Church has been involved for centuries in human sacrifice, with some of it occurring in the Vatican itself. Now, when I was in Rome, I happened to interview a girl that witnessed child sacrificing as a child down in the catacombs of the Vatican, a human sacrifice of a young boy. This woman that I interviewed happened to commit suicide as well, months later, so they say. Now, for centuries they've been involved in this, with some of it occurring in the Vatican itself. But those sacrifices have been occurring in other places as well, tended by major leaders of the world who are controlled by the Vatican, perhaps at Bohemian Grove or other places that they pick, on these hidden away sites. There is an effigy of the god of Moloch, one of their pagan gods, has been erected, and eyewitnesses have said children and adults have been sacrificed to it. Interesting. But with this, so if they conduct satanic rituals, and this has been going on for centuries, why not introduce the real truth behind the Vatican and the Holocaust? Now, I want to take some information that I got years ago and bring it back to you, just so you understand the gravity. And if you want to remember the Holocaust, let's talk about some real things that never get talked about. The Holocaust, it was a mass sacrifice, I believe, of over 18 million innocent Protestants, Orthodox Christians, ethnic Jews, and minority groups by burning several million of them alive in ovens in Poland and Russia. And that was less than 70 or 80 years ago. And I say by Catholic dictators, Adolf Hitler. Go to the quotes of Hitler saying he modeled his organization after the Jesuits and Father Joseph Stalin, S.J. I say that because he represents the largest and most expansive act of mass human sacrifice in history that never gets the attention. The effort to efficiently sacrifice the largest number of non-Catholics in 25x7 purpose-built ovens, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, was a massive logistical effort, not the least of which required the competent, complete genealogy analysis of most of Europe. If not for the genius of the American technology company IBM, who created the first computers for the task of confirming who were to be saved and who were to be slaughtered, and that was a Western company. What were they doing? Is that ever brought up by Sean Hannity or by the CNN guys who are supposedly persecuting poor Sean? If not for the hundreds of millions of dollars in research by the pharmaceutical companies in advance, nerve agents to render people unconscious in gas chambers for easy transport to the ovens, then the plan would have been impossible. So ask yourself this. Do you think that these people were killed in the showers and then just disposed of in the ovens, or were they still breathing and used as a satanic ritual? And on this Holocaust Day, I think that's a good question to think about. And knowing the Vatican's past and knowing the importance of these secret societies working with them and satanic rituals going on even today, that question needs to be answered. But it never will in the mainstream. But most of all, if not for the really willing and support by Allied leaders not to interfere with this project, the Nazis managed to kill more innocent people by fire in 1944 and 45 than all other years combined. So why were we so late to take action, America? Why didn't we come to Poland's aid in the beginning? I asked that question because many of my family were killed. At the end of the war, the first thing that the Allies did, under, I call, Jesuit Eisenhower, was to pull down and dig up as much incriminating evidence as possible. Many of the oven blocks ahead of any other buildings were quickly dismantled and destroyed in many of the camps. Some camps, such as the only human sacrifice camp dedicated to burning children at Lodz, Poland, L-O-D-Z, one you never hear about, was virtually wiped from the map of history. And by the time the Nuremberg trials started, secretly, remember, I directed by Georgetown University Jesuit priest Edmund Walsh, who started the School of Foreign Service that still exists today and trains most of our diplomats. Many of these key Nazis behind the Holocaust were given fake deaths or safely transported to new countries and new identities. The total number sacrificed was set at an acceptable level of 6 million, and no mention of the Roman Catholic Church or the cult and the Roman Catholic statues at the camps, nor the cult symbols and signs, or the priests involved in this, was ever officially mentioned at the trials of hundreds of guards and officers. And that's why Edmund Walsh was there, to control the judge. Now, in appreciating that the Holocaust was not about killing Jews only, but about killing non-Catholics, one can begin to see the Vatican hidden agenda behind what happened. And we can start to see how valuable and clever a focus on the Jewish Holocaust was to cover up the truth. And that's what I'm talking about when I talk about the media and the left and the right fighting, saying that heresy laws are being put on the conservatives. The heresy laws are put on us who try to get this truth out. And there are many people out there who are silenced. Now, let's see how much time I have to finish this up. Yeah, I got about 5 minutes. We don't really know became the official line of denial fed to the public of the winning side. Even evidence was conveniently found calling it the final solution to the Jewish question in a former Gestapo headquarters. The window of sacrifice was cut short from 39 to 45, 1945, to just 3 years, 1943 to 45, to minimize the complicity of Allied leaders. Yet, of all the terrible and criminal lies created by the CFR, Jesuit-led American military, and the British military, it was the argument that people were gassed to death because it was cheaper. That remains the final and lasting insult to some of the darkest days of history. Could it be that wasn't the reason? That was to be a human sacrifice to their pagan gods. Quite interesting, isn't it? So, 20 million people could have been murdered the same as many other dictators had done throughout history, simply by mass murder, burial, then incineration, or bodies disposed by creating great pits as it was done during the plagues of Europe hundreds of years before, which killed 10 times more people. Yet the evil charade that the Holocaust was merely a hatefully racist, expedient Nazi system of cost-saving extermination remains the accepted view, an absurdity that defies all the evidence to the contrary. The main architects of this terrible period remain protected. To this day, is a mockery to the memory of every Jew, every Russian Orthodox, every Greek Orthodox, every Protestant, every Baptist, and every person sacrificed in those ovens. It's incredible. Now, what I read to you in these last few paragraphs, I took from Frankel Collins, who had been on my show many years before, and we talked much about this. And since then, I've gotten, like I said, two or three verifications from people whose names I have to keep silent. But anyway, think of it in those terms. So to get true, if you want to remember truthfully what happened and give people their, instead of mocking them and saying it was an expedient way and the Vatican was not involved, look at the, basically what's being hidden from you on this day. Now, this anti-Semitic, anti-minority hatred prior to World War II was orchestrated by none other than the Jesuits. And I don't make that statement lightly, but that's exactly what they did. Most Catholic dictators were comfortable with the idea that the public would not erupt in rebellion if minorities were to be safely removed from society. However, a powerful new enemy appeared at the same time against the propaganda of the Jesuits, spurned hatred and fear. Pope Pius XI himself, the Pope, had become a fervent critic of the hatefully racist policies now being carried out by Roman Catholic dictators, thanks to a Pole himself, Jesuit Father Ledecky, and a Jesuit and a very hardliner who basically helped orchestrate the killing of many of his own people. So, there's much more to be talked about, and I hope this helps set the record straight of what most likely occurred. If the Vatican's history is what it is, it least needs to be put on the table, but why is it never talked about in these terms? And when you start really, there's much more. Maybe I'll do another show regarding how they even created a pentagram in Poland out of the prison camps, out of the concentration camps like Auschwitz and the others. And that's a very interesting story. Another way of, again, worshiping their pagan gods. So, anyway, we're all out of time. Spread the show around. Truth needs to be told. And we'll be back again tomorrow on the Investigative Journal.
The book of Revelation says, "The spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus Christ." This is at the very heart of FirstAmendmentRadio.com. In that spirit, we have created the Prophecy Reality News app for all of your mobile devices, streaming First Amendment Radio 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Available for your Apple, Android device, and smartphone, absolutely free. Get the Prophecy Reality News app installed today so you can listen to First Amendment Radio wherever you are. The Prophecy.
Since the beginning of time, kings have sought it, nations have fought for it, it has been traded, it has been borrowed, it has been purchased, it has been stolen, there's a reason for it. To secure the blessings of liberty, to ourselves and to our posterity, invest with the security of gold and silver. Call Discount Gold and Silver Trading at 1-800-375-4188 or visit discountgoldandsilvertrading.net. Listen to Financial Survival with your host, Melody Cedarstrom, right here on FirstAmendmentRadio.com at 4 p.m. Eastern or 1 p.m. Pacific Time. Visit discountgoldandsilvertrading.net or call Discount Gold and Silver Trading at 1-800-375-4188. Toll free, 1-800-375-4188.